Praise the Lord, everybody. Aren't y'all glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Not only are you here this morning, but today is our Christmas service. Come on. I know y'all more excited than that. Come on. Well, we're about to open it up with some worship songs, so I know that we're all kind of sitting down and feeling comfortable. If we can come around the front and just begin to praise God and begin to worship Him, lift Him up, because of course He is the reason for the season. It wasn't just something that the shopping, all the Walmarts and everything's like that came up with just so that they could be able to make a sale on things. But it was ultimately God came down and wrote Himself in flesh and dwelt among us. So I'm so thankful that He is the reason. Amen. Let's worship Him.
I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Well, I'm a little tired of devil's games, keeping me in bondage to my sorrows and pains. I deserve better, I won't go another day. I'm here to claim deliverance in Jesus' name. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Well, I have royal blood flowing through my veins. I'm a child of the King. I've been buried in His name. There is no devil that can come against me. I've been blessed, I've been born, I've been set free. I feel the joy of the Lord fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. When I have been loosed, I've been set free. So pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. When I have been loosed, I've been set free. So pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me.
Hallelujah.
I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord. In fact, it has been said that the house of the Lord is the safest place on the planet Earth. Praise God. Yes, I know there's accidents that happen, but I'm glad I'm in a safe place. This is the Lord's house. It's more than striped candy at Christmas. It's more than just coming to church and just having pretty tables and a good meal. It's more than just coming and clapping your hands. It's more than shouting. It's more than speaking in tongues. Praise God. All that's good. I like it. But I tell you what I really like about it. I'm in love with Him. And if you can keep that intact, you'll never go wayward. If you'll never put God in question, you'll never go wayward. It's not about the preacher. It's not about a Sunday school teacher. It's about putting Him in question. Hallelujah. Clap your hands unto the Lord. Praise God, praise God. It is so good to see everyone here today, and it's good to see David Press's dad and stepmother here, and it's good to have them being with us today, and let's give them a hand. Brother and Sister Preston, good to have you on the house of the Lord. Praise God, all the way from the state. Is it Tennessee? Kentucky? Kentucky. All right, missed it one state. They're over, huh? I told them, I said, when they come to Texas, they got to have their spurs, cowboy hats, and cowboy boots. Six-shooters on, nah. You'd be shocked, surprised, all those people outside of this state, they think, man, if you go to Texas, you got to have all that. They've seen so many Western movies. It's not that. Now, if you go to East Texas, where I come from, you might think you're You might think you're not on Beverly Hillbillies, but you might think you're in Gunsmoke area. Over here, you might be in Beverly Hillbillies. No, I'm just kidding. But anyway, I'm glad to have them. I'm glad to see all the smiling faces. This is a special day. And we're not here. I mean, we're here to eat a meal. We're here to sing a few songs. We're here to glorify the name. But more than anything, just put Jesus Christ is the reason for this season. And that's really what it's all about. I'm glad that I'm not mixed up with some other gods. He's not the only God. He really isn't. He's not the only God. He is the only King of Kings. Y'all catch that? Other words, He's the God of all gods. Praise God. When I speak of my God, I speak of a big G-O-D, God. When I speak of all the other gods, it's little G-O-D. Now, I will say this. What God are you serving? The small, lowercase G-O-D? Are you serving the one that's big G-O-D? The only true God, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the rose and shared, the bright and morning star, the first and the last, the author and finisher of my faith. I'm glad that I serve the one true God. Hallelujah. Clap your hands, all you people. Praise God, praise God. Y'all enjoy the music. Thank God for all the musicians. I think they deserve a good hand there. We have a lot of them out, but I tell you what, I prayed this morning because my wife said, honey, we're a lot of the singers are going to be out, and it's tough on Misty and blah, 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 blah. I said, God, send the angels in this place to join them. I want them to sing, and I want other voices. What's wrong with that? Praise God. I'm telling you, they can make it, God can make it sound like an orchestra when you got two people, because He's still God. Go ahead and clap your hands one more time unto the Lord, for He is worthy of every praise, every thanksgiving. Let's enjoy this day of serving the Lord today, okay? Let's enjoy this day. It's going to be a great day, great day. Great fellowship. Love people, give them a chance. Praise God, forgive and release and let God have this day. I'm excited. Go ahead and sing unto the Lord. God bless you. Worship Him.
Falling in love.
Choosing songs for this morning, I chose this song for a reason. Because at this time of year, you know, we as apostolic Christians, we strive to be thankful, we strive to live for God every single day. But for some reason, during the holiday season, there's a lot more reminders that I see around me, that, you know, things that happen during the holiday season that reminds me of the love of God, reminds me that He came down to this earth, robed Himself in flesh. I mean, He made that ultimate sacrifice so that we might be saved. And with all of the reminders around me during this holiday season, it makes me fall in love with Him all over again. It just has that effect on me. And so that's the reason why I chose this song this morning. And I want y'all to think on the words of this song and worship. Remember what God has done for you and fall in love with Him all over again.
Falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus is the best thing I've ever done.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus, we worship You. We thank You. I'm so glad that one day I fell in love with You. No one can ever take that place from me, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Is that the best thing you ever did? When you fell in love with Jesus, your life completely changed and completely turned around. If y'all's in it, I know mine did. When I fell in love with Jesus at this altar, my life was never the same. Things that I thought I was going to do in my life completely changed. My priorities completely changed. And now my priority is everything that has to do with Him. Amen. Let's worship God and let's continue to love Him.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive the King. Let every heart prepare Him room, and heaven and nature
talk, but you know, the rest of the service we have planned traditional Christmas carols, but I don't want y'all to just say the words. Everybody knows these songs, you can sing along, but really listen to the words and let them speak to your heart, because every one of these songs has a meaning. Every one of these songs were written for a reason. The song we just sang, Joy to the World, think on those words. Christ came to the world. He is our joy. And everybody in this world receives their joy from Christ. Some of you who've been out in the world and now you're living for God, think on the difference in your joy level. Your joy level is different when you're living for God compared to when you're not. So I want you all to think on the words of each one of these songs. Don't just go through the motions, but let them speak to your heart. Sing along and worship with these songs, because these songs are about Jesus.
Praise the Lord, everybody. If you want to, you can go back to your seats and sit down for a little bit. It says I'm gonna give y'all a devotional. I didn't look up what the definition of devotional meant, but Brother Chandler just said don't go over 20 minutes, so I guess that's the definition, nothing over 20 minutes. Don't worry, I usually, even when I preach, I usually don't take 20 minutes, so it's okay, so I won't keep y'all long. So, this is our Christmas service. We're celebrating Christ's birth, but this is what I kept thinking, and I was when I was talking to one of my friends last night when I was trying to come up with everything for this message, I was saying, why is Christmas so important? Why is it that, you know, Jesus came, Jesus was born, but why is that so important? They're like, well, he's the Savior of the world. I'm like, well, yeah, but what does that mean? It was like, yes, that's important. Yes, he's the Savior of the world. Yes, he saved us. You know, if it wasn't for him being birthed, he couldn't, of course, die on a cross, which means we wouldn't be saved from our sins. But what did that mean to them? What did Savior mean to them? What ultimately, like, if we, because of course, us in the present time, we didn't know Jesus when he was, you know, of course, on this earth. We didn't see him when he died, and we didn't see him when he resurrected. We can partake in the effects of all of that because we're Holy Ghost filled. We've been baptized in Jesus' name, so we can partake in all the effects of that, but we weren't there when all of this transpired, when all of this happened. So what does that mean? Well, that's what I'm going to talk to y'all about. What Christmas actually means, what that meant to them. First off, I wanted to give the first prophecy that God gave that he was going to come in bodily form and come and save the world. It says in Genesis 3:15, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So, when it says that it that it's referring to, the it it's referring to is the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman is going to bruise thy head. And when he was talking to the serpent, but we know that Satan was using the serpent because later on in Scripture, you can go into Revelation and you can see where it talks about the dragon, and it says that old serpent, the devil. So it knows, I mean, when it says that old serpent, I mean, it says old, so obviously it must be pretty old serpent. It's talking about Genesis. So, says, it shall bruise thy head. What is, I mean, is it talking about he's just going to stomp on the serpent's head? No, it's a lot of times head is used as dominion. So the dominion that Satan had over us, the dominion that he held over us, was one day going to be bruised. It was going to go away. But does that mean that when, because of course, after the, when Jesus, when God has given us prophecy about him, providing a seed, providing a savior, was that just a backup plan because man messed up? Or was that just like, he's like, oh well, man, you messed up, so it's okay, I guess I can fix your mistake. In Revelation 13:8, it says, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him. And when it's talking about worship him, it's talking about worshiping the devil, whose names are not written in the book of the life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. The Lamb was slain from the foundation of the world. So that means with the entire world being created, the Lamb was already slain. So God already knew what he was going to do. God already knew that he was going to come in bodily form. God already knew he was going to provide a Savior from the very beginning. It wasn't because man messed up, but that was what God had in the forefront of his mind from the very beginning. It wasn't a backup plan, but it was the plan to begin with. Now, that doesn't mean that God planned for man to fail, but that means that God was willing to die for man before man was even created. In 2 Timothy 1:9, it says, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works. Who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given in us Christ Jesus, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. Every prophecy, everything that God did, it was all with that one birth, of course, what we're celebrating Christmas, with that one birth in view, what that meant for them was so much fulfillment of prophecy. That none of these prophecies about, you know, God pouring out His Spirit upon all flesh, the restoration of Israel, all of these different things. Yes, they were physical things that did later on happen, but all of the spiritual restoration that God was talking about Him dwelling with us and about how we were going to know His name, none of that could be fulfilled if it wasn't first for the birth. In Titus 1 and 2, it says, "In the hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began." So before creation, before everything was created, this was His purpose, that He was one day going to dwell with man. In Matthew 1:18-21, this is talking about the birth of Jesus. It says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on the wise when, as His mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together," that talks about before the marriage was consummated, "she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband," because of course they weren't married yet, so he's like, this girl's having a baby that ain't mine. So "then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not willing to make her a public example because he loved her," he didn't want to just call her out in public saying, "Man, she's having a child out of wedlock, it ain't even mine," "but he was minded to put her away privily," meaning he was going to do it in private, "but while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus." And then it says what that name Jesus meant, "for he shall save his people from their sins." It also goes further. Matthew 2:1-2, it says, "Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." So why... These wise men later on, if you do some studying, you can find out they're actually magi there, which is short for magician, which is, of course, when you're reading in Daniel, it says that they came before magicians and wise men. And so how did they know? I mean, they see this North Star appear. It says, "We saw his star." How did they know that was his star? How did they know about this? Well, something that's amazing as well is not only did God have this as his have him coming in bodily form, like, you know, not only was that his purpose to begin with, but with every single prophecy, it was centered on that. So when God was punishing Israel and they would have to go into captivity and all these different things, what God was really doing was God was spreading the gospel. Even though he was also punishing Israel, at the same time he was spreading the gospel and getting the earth prepared for his coming. That's how they knew. They came all the way from where Babylon was. It says that the distance they traveled could have taken them months, like 3 months or something, I think like 3 or 4 months, to get to Jesus, following his star. That reason they knew about that star was, like I said, every single prophecy, it was all given. When God said to Abraham, "I'm going to give you a land, I'm going to give you a seed, I'm going to give you a promise." Something else that was added to that, the promise, of course, was that he was going to have a child, or that he was going to make his name great, make a great nation. So the name great, that's a promise. "I'm going to give you a seed. You know, you're going to have many nations." Then he says that you're going to have a land. It's going to be the land of Israel, or at that time it was Canaan. But there is something else that was also given to him. It says, "And these shall all the nations of the earth be blessed." It's because through him he was going, that would be the bloodline, of course, to where it would one day be Christ coming into this world. And then through Christ, all the nations of the earth were going to be blessed. It was all done with the Son in view, all done with Jesus in view. Aren't y'all thankful for that? Man, y'all being quiet on me. I mean, I'm not sure if y'all are thankful for it. Now, this next scripture is Actually, I was meaning to read verse 9 of Matthew 2, verse 9. It says, and when they heard the king, they departed. Lo, the star was in the east, went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. So, again, the reason that they knew of the star was because of prophecy. That just shows God, it's according to his own purpose and grace. His purpose was to dwell with man. He loved man so much that he wanted to dwell with them. He was like, you know what? I see that man keeps messing up, but I want to dwell with them. I want to see, am I asking too much? Am I asking too much of them? He wanted to dwell with man. But ultimately, something that's more, that's further than that, not just dwelling with man, not just providing a savior, he wanted relationship. That's what it all ties to. That's why I'm thankful for Christmas. Because I can have relationship. If it wasn't for Christmas, if it wasn't for him, which, I mean, I know we say Christmas and that's December 25th is the day that we choose to celebrate Jesus coming. We know that he probably didn't come on December 25th, but you know what? It don't matter. If I don't know when someone's birthday is and I choose to celebrate their birthday on January 6th, I'm celebrating on January 6th, all right? It don't matter if that was when he was actually birthed. That's just when I choose to celebrate it. But like I said, I can go, I'm not going to read all these scriptures. I thought I might, but I'm not going to. Actually, one thing real quick. It says in Luke chapter 1, verse 27. It says, to a virgin, God sent an angel, Gabriel, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph in the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. My friend that I was talking to also said, well, why was Mary chosen? She was highly favored. She was highly favored. What obtaining the favor of the Lord means, of course, facing the ridicule. She was accused of committing adultery, committing fornication. She was accused of all these things, but she had obtained the favor of the Lord. She was even saying, I don't even know how to take this. I don't even know how to take this salutation. I don't know how to take this greeting. Am I supposed to take it good or am I supposed to take it bad? Is this a blessing or a curse? But when the angel went and began to explain to her, you know the song that says, Mary, did you know? Yeah, Mary knew. It was explained to her. She knew. She knew what it meant. She was the one that came to Jesus. When Jesus was going out and did his first miracle, turned the water into wine, she was the one that said, hey, I know what you can do. You need to go do it. She knew. She knew what her baby boy was. She knew her baby. She didn't. She may not have known that he may have specifically walked on water, but she knew what he was. She knew what was born in her. She knew what was birthed in her. She knew it was a miracle. She knew it was the Savior of the world, and she knew what that meant. And that's why, of course, I said all of this, is I don't want us to forget what the meaning of it is. Yes, I know that the purpose of Christmas was that Jesus came in bodily form. Or, you know, we see God and we, you know, come in bodily form as the person of Jesus, and we see that name that is revealed, the name that has all power. I mean, it's so amazing because this is something else that y'all don't understand. In the Old Testament, when they would say Jehovah Jireh, when they would say Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Shalom, you know, healer, peace, comforter, friend, holy, you know, when they say all these things, they can only give attributes to God. But now, that's why it says everything that you do, everything that you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of Jesus. Because when I call on the name of Jesus, that's when I call on my healer. When I call on the name of Jesus, that's when I call on my peace. It's the culminating name. It culminates every, that means it takes all the names. When you say Jesus, it takes all of it. It covers it all. Whatever you need at the time, that's what the name of Jesus is for. Exactly. You don't have to go to the Old Testament. You don't have to go to a high priest. It says that you can come boldly before the throne of grace. That means that you can come, and you can come expecting that God's going to hear you. Aren't y'all thankful that Jesus was born? Amen. I'm so thankful. Can we just stand a little bit? You know, just all around the building, if we can just stand and begin to worship him. begin to thank him for what he did, for coming in bodily form. Jesus, we thank you. I'm so thankful that you came and that you were born. I'm so thankful for all that you've done, oh God.
could have all of our children come up, we have a special song from our children.
there's one thing I can say. I'm standing between you and one song and that lunch. I can hear your bellies growling now. If y'all would worship as much as your bellies are growling, we're going to have a move of God in here. I love it. You know, I'm so excited about what God's doing. And when I say that, I'm talking about there's always an undercurrent of the Holy Ghost, things that you don't see. And I'm beginning to tap into some things that everywhere I go, I'm thinking as of an opportunity to talk to somebody about God or witness or bring them into a better relationship with the Lord. And some folks you come up to and you think, well, they're not wrapped in a good enough package. Jesus never judged who I was when I came to him. I'm glad of that. I'd like to read a scripture here in the first chapter of Matthew, and it says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from his sins," their sins. "Now all this was done that it might fulfill which was spoken by the Lord the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted, God with us." I'd like to title my little devotion. I won't take long. It's not a full sermon, but it is a thought provoking, something that I think that we all need every day or once a week, a thought provoking, and that is this: his arrival assures our survival. His arrival assures our survival. You know what? That wonderful night, that celebration, was a clear night, but yet it's supposed to be something very spiritual. Israel was under the attack of Roman rule, and religion had become a total sham, and faith was very low, and the economy was poor, and night was very dark, talking about physically. But beyond the safad, beyond the physical, there was something great spiritually happened. Church, I believe that we're in that place right now, that all we see is gloom and doom, but there is a child that was born in the gloom and the gloomy time when the economy was down and faith was low, and it was just in a total sham. But the wonders of all of this is that Jesus himself came in the middle of our mess. He didn't come in a good circumstance. Came in a chaotic world. And he came for one reason. There had to be a plan of redemption. God himself, Spirit alone, knew that he could not redeem man by itself. He had to have blood. He had to have a body. And that blood and that body was Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Now, the situation can be a disaster. Conditions of the people spiritually probably may be horrible. But he came anyhow. How many times did you have it together when God came to your rescue? He really didn't. You didn't really have it together. Anytime anyone ever comes to God, it's usually in tragic situation. It's in a situation that they cannot get out of themselves. But I'm glad that he came anyhow. Yeah. I'm glad that he came anyway. Yeah. In the midst of my mess, he came and met me. Yeah. Praise God. Yes, I know we were speaking and talking about songs, speaking and or singing songs of him coming, you know, and baby in a manger and all this, but it goes beyond that. It goes beyond just his birth. He grew up to be my Savior. He was in that manger as my Savior. And nothing could kill him. Nothing could destroy him. He came anyhow. So no wonder Christianity was so grand, that God of the universe, that he was willing to stoop so low in the middle of my mess and made and willed himself to help me out of it. You know, I'm looking across this congregation today, and I'm sure that circumstances are not too good in some of your lives. I'm sure that every one of y'all would like a miracle, and I'm sure that there's some of you have received miracles. There's that group of people that says God's been good, and I'm much better off than I was a year ago, 2 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago. God's been good, and I understand, and that's great and well. But there are those that says I'm waiting on my miracle. Don't wait any longer. He came in a manger. He is your miracle. Now, understand, the miracle may not happen today. But I'm glad in the longevity of living for God, when I look over the years, the circumstances that I was in 10 years ago are so minimized now, because God took care of it 10 years ago. 2 years from that, 8 years ago, I might have had some kind of situation going on in my life that I thought, my God, it's the end of it. I look back 8 years, and I says, God took care of it. And I look back 5 years from now, God took care of it. And I look back 3 years from now, God took care of it. And I look back, and I see those things that I've went through, and they're so minimum now, minimized. And I thought, back then, I thought, now, I think, how did I go through that? I'll tell you how you went through it. You went through it because we have a Savior. When you went through it, I like to illustrate that. I went through it, and I came out on the other end of my trouble. That's what I'm speaking about today. Aren't you glad that we've got a Savior? Aren't you glad that he came in the middle of your mess? Aren't you glad that he delivered you in the middle of your mess? And some of you are here today wondering when you're going to get your miracle. I believe it's coming. But you can't give up in the middle of it. You cannot throw in the towel. I was talking to someone yesterday, and I came up to him, and I knew a little history about it, knew a little struggles he's went through, and he was a preacher. And I asked him, I said, I need to talk to you just for a few minutes, just put your paintbrush down. And I said, you know, what happened? He began to tell me a story. He said, it's not you, it's not the church I used to pastor. I had an issue with God. Folks, I'm praying that God will use me as a breach between me and someone I'd be speaking to the choir if I begin to preach to him. I can't do that. But God give me wisdom to know how to get in and unlock some things to get him back on course again. Church, don't ever give up on your promise. Don't ever give up. I'm glad that he stooped down in the middle of my mess and he willed it to me, my miracle. I just marvel a lot at his grace, his love, his mercy that he's always offering to all of us. You know, none of us are excluded, regardless of culture, race, creed, childhood, upbringing, present conditions, the barn, the baby that was born in the barnyard. You hear me? Barnyard baby. Still is able to reach you at any extent. Even though he took himself, he claimed himself as a man, but yet he stooped so low and became, he said, I'll give you the hotel. I will give you everything. He never owned a car. Wasn't no cars back then. He never owned his own home. He never owned anything because he gave everything away to you and I. He is called the day star from high, the bright and morning star, the lily of the valley, first and the last, the dawning of a new day. And those who are honest enough to see their need must find some way, somehow, to seek him out. Oh, it's not time to quit. It's not time to get better. It's not time to get hard. It's time to give him everything that is deserving to him. And that's my worship toward him. It seems that our present day is also anything but clear. Issues are getting clouded, concepts perverted, ideas are being forsaken, disloyalty on every corner, beliefs are ridiculed, faith seems to be mocked, and yet he is still born in the heart of everyone. He is still there. He's still knocking on doors and wanting to become what? A Savior. Aren't you glad today that he never gave up? Oh, this is something that I want to press into the crowd today, every one of you. And this is what he needs. All he needs is a little room to get in. That's it. Just push things aside and say, today I want to make room for him. Because when most of the time when God comes into our lives, we're so distracted, and our rooms are so full and so packed and so dysfunctioned and all of these things. And he says, just give me a little room. You know, I've always believed this. If you will just give God a little bit, I don't care if you're struggling, and I don't care if you think, well, I just don't know. But if you'll just give God a little bit of room inside, just get him in the house. Just get him in the house. What house? This house. Give him a little room, and then watch God begin to do some great things. That's what I really believe. That's the God that I serve today. Because if you'll just give him a little room among all of the clutter and all of the junk that's in our lives, and I believe that he will do the rest. If we'll just make room for his arrival, for our survival. Because Jesus Christ has to have something to work with something, a little bit of something to work with. If you're weak in faith, give him that portion of area of where it's weak and watch God work. You know, I've always been a sticker of this, and I believe that what I say this morning, that maybe if you'll do the same thing, you'll probably find out that it's good. If I'm weak on faith, I will read something on faith. If I'm weak in my giving to the Lord, I will read something on giving. If I'm weak as a servant, I'm going to read something that projects giving. A heart that gives out. I'm talking about servanthood now. I've always liked to read things that will feed my mind in the right direction. Remember this. His arrival is for my survival. We can starve him out of our lives while we feed our fleshly desires, our emotions that will lie to us and drive us in the wrong direction. He claims to be the light of the world. The good news is we need to let him be the light of the world. In an unclear, unsured, unfriendly, unholy, unwilling world, we need a clear beacon to lead us and guide us and direct us and comfort us in a time of struggles. You know what? Before the musicians come up here, come on up here if you'd like. I want us all to stand and I want us to pray. I want us to pray. Heavenly Father, I come to you today, loving you, praising you. God, you came down for my survival. You came down to save me from myself. God, we're here today, and every one of us need to be saved from ourselves. Father, the devil is not my worst enemy. His back was broken at Calvary. There's some things that happened at Calvary that the devil cannot do. I give him no credit today. But God, I tell you what, Lord, it's me. It's in my decisions. It's in my choices. Father, I'm the one that invites trouble into my life. I'm the one that makes decisions to serve you or not serve you. And God, today I pray over this congregation that every one of us would begin to make wise choices, falling in love with God all over again. And let him become our Savior. Let him save us from ourselves, which is our worst enemy. And Father, as we raise our hands and worship him in song, Father, Lord, thank you for spirit and truth. Thank you, Lord, for being clear. Thank you, Lord, for being sure. Thank you, Lord, for being friendly to us and loving us. Father, I'm thankful for a holy life. And I'm thankful, Lord, that you were so willing to come down into my mess when I desperately needed you. Father, you came down when I was saved many, many years ago, but God, I've had a lot of messes since then. I've had a lot of circumstances since then, Lord, that you still took care of. And today, Lord, we have something all over this congregation here that God needs to give somebody a miracle. Just remember this, if there's anything that I want to say this morning. His arrival will assure you of your survival. God bless you. As they sing, I tell you what, I want everybody in the house to sing. And we'll dismiss you after that, have a meal, and let's have a good day today. God bless you.
Also, while they're singing and we're singing, if we can come and give our offering, we'll receive it. So just do that as they're singing.
In this house, in this place, Lord, let your presence fill.
Christmas is a time that sometimes we get real busy and we forget exactly what's going on around us. So for just a minute, you know what I want us to do? I want us to join hands. I want us to get our family together. This is Christmas. You're my family. You're it, buddy. Grab hands. Grab somebody's hand. Come on, move around. Get a hand. Get a hand. This is your family. And when I get with my family at Christmas, buddy, I hug and I kiss and I squeeze and I laugh and I want to touch my family because I love my family. And for one more time, I want us to sing that chorus, the end of that chorus, one more time. And I want us to get with our family. And I want you to know how much Pastor and I love you. You know, the last few months we've been horrible busy with this house. And we have, every time we pray, it's Lord, forgive me. And then we say, oh Lord, forgive me for that too. And forgive me for that. Because we feel like we're just not connected. And I hate that. But you are our family and we love you. And Pastor and I wish you the best Christmas ever. So we're going to sing that chorus one more time, and we're going to do it with our family.
As we
you for that person that you have in arms. Thank you for this beautiful house that you've given us.
Clap your hands unto the Lord. Praise God, praise God. Now, I want to remind you of Christmas for Christ, and it's kind of moving in on us. You don't have to get your money in before Christmas if it's tight. You can go to February, and that will, I would like to see a good, those envelopes are on the very back, should be. Are they back there? If you'd like to grab an envelope, pray over it, say, this is my envelope for the year. Brother Frank Cockrell's got him in his hand back there. Show everybody. Grab you one, read it over. And if you would like, now this is something I'd like to do. I've taken up collection for small amounts of someone that doesn't have much money. And we're going to sponsor a family that maybe out of work or whatever. So if you want to give to that as well, you be sure you mark it on an envelope and give that, because I'm specifically going for